Hello YouTubers, my name is Attila Mate from Blue Sky Photography, and today I would like to talk to you about the most common question what I get in my comments from my followers or from viewers, you know, who watch my videos. So the most common question would be, what kind of camera should I buy? Now I have to tell you that many times people will ask this question, but you have to understand that if you put this question, what kind of camera should I buy? This is a very, very complex question. And I want to speak a little bit about this topic in detail, so you can understand much better the complexity of this question. So first of all, let's see a few criteria how to choose the best camera for your work. Now, when we talk about what kind of camera should I buy, first of all, we have to talk about what kind of photography are you into. This is the first question. Sports photography, wildlife photography, wedding photography, portrait photography, real estate and architectural, product photography, landscape photography. All these kind of territories of the photography will require some aspects in your camera to be in there. So let's call it, the camera should be able to handle some situations for each and every territory of photography. Now, the second most important factor, which one you have to consider, is obviously your budget. Because if money is not a problem for you, then you can buy whatever camera you want and whatever camera you, the expensive one, you know, and most of the time, the top of the range, you know, like the flagship camera of each Nikon, Canon, Sony, Olympus, Fujifilm, whatever brand you want, the top of the line, the flagship camera will handle most of the situations. Now, even then, I would say that in some situations, you have to choose differently. And I will explain to you why. So first of all, let's take one territory by one after the other, and let's talk a little bit about what kind of camera should you buy. So first is sports photography. If you are into sports photography, in my opinion, the most important thing what you have to take in consideration when you buy camera is autofocus. Autofocus tracking, it has to be super, super good if you are in sports photography, because your subjects are moving very, very fast. And if they are moving fast, you must have good tracking in your camera. In this case scenario, we are talking about the flagship cameras again, you know, like the Nikon D5, Canon 1DX, Sony A9, and these cameras, you know, they are very expensive, very pricey. They are 6,000 euro, the Nikon D5 is 6,500 euro, Canon is again like something like that. I'm not familiar with Canon's price point, but something like that. Sony A9 is 4,500 euro. Now you can go in the same time with APS-C, because these three cameras were full frame. You can go in the same time with APS-C, and then you can buy the Nikon D500, you can buy the Sony A6500, you can buy the Fujifilm X-T2, you can buy the Olympus EM-1 Mark II, and these cameras are great. They have great autofocus and great tracking. In some situations, the Fujifilm X-T2 is even better than the Nikon D500. In some situation, that is proven, that is a fact. I'm an Nikon user, but at the same time, I'm a very realistic person, so I admit that. Now, the second category is wildlife photography. In wildlife photography, again, for sports and wildlife, these two, usually I will recommend the same kind of cameras, because in wildlife you need, again, very fast tracking. If you are in birds photography or animals, you know, they are moving, you need good tracking, autofocus tracking. But in the same time, you are tempted to use more the APS-C size sensor, because that sensor gives you the extra reach, and also in the same time, you will have more pixel density in the smaller sensor. Because I don't want to talk about too much about pixel density, because the video would be too long. I have in my channel a video about pixel density, and if you search around, you will find it. And in that I will explain what's the positive in pixel density. So if you are in sports or wildlife, you need more pixel density and you need more details in your shot. So that's why APS-C size sensor is more appealing to you. In the same time, I don't say that full frame is not better, or it's up to your personal preference. You have to choose, you want APS-C or full frame. Now, the third one is wedding photography. Again, in this situation with wedding photography, in my opinion, there are three aspects you have to be careful when you want to buy into a system like a wedding photographer. You have to be careful about the low light capability of the camera, one. Second, you have to be careful about the autofocus of the camera. And third, you have to be careful about the lens possibilities, the lens selection of the camera, because you need various different lenses for your work. And if you need different lenses, you must be sure that you will have those lenses in the system where you want to get into. Now, what kind of cameras would I recommend for wedding photography? If you want full frame cameras, you can get the Nikon D750, and that is a great camera for wedding photography. Again, you can do different, you can do with APS-C, you can do with full frame. It's up to you, it's up to personal preference, but in the same time, it's also up to your budget. So you know your budget and you know what kind of cameras you are able to buy. From Canon, I would say obviously the Canon 5D Mark IV, you know, or the, even the 5D Mark III, they are great cameras in full frame. Again, if you want to go APS-C, I would recommend the Nikon D500 and Nikon D7200. Yeah, they are both great cameras. Even the Nikon 7100, you know, that's a great camera. The low light capability is not as good as the Nikon D500, obviously, but in the same time you can add light. So it's up to you, it's up to your shooting style, and it's up to your budget, which one you want to buy. With all these cameras, you are able to do the job, I guarantee that. So the next is portrait photography. What do you need in portrait photography? In my opinion, in portrait photography, you need fast glass. Autofocus is not really important for you, because in portraits you can focus manually, so that's not an issue. Autofocus is out of the game. And in my opinion, for portrait photography, is what is important, the skin tones and the fast glass. So in this case, I would recommend, if you want full frame cameras, I would recommend again the Nikon D810 or the Nikon D750. I would recommend the Pentax K1, which is a great camera for portraits, I tell you. Great details, great sensor, very, very good sensors. Now, the lens availability of the Pentax is obviously not as big as Nikon or Canon, but in the same time, it is enough for portraits. You have a lot of third-party options. You have, from Pentax, you have great lenses, so it's okay. And price-wise, the camera is very good. Now, again, I recommend from the Canon, the 5D Mark IV and 5D Mark III. They are great cameras again. They are a little bit pricey, but look, that's how it is. If you want to go APS-C, you can buy the same cameras like for wedding, you know, the Nikon D500, Nikon D7200. I don't want to speak about the Canon side because I don't really have experience with Canon. You also can buy from Sony. You can buy the A7. You can buy the A7R if you have money. A7R is a great camera, 42 megapixel, great autofocus. It is a great camera for portraits and even for landscapes, you know, it's a great camera. If you are happy with the lens lineup and if you are happy with the prices of the lenses, excellent camera. So the next is the real estate and architectural photography. In most situations, you know, any camera will do for this job, because you don't need autofocus, you don't need, I mean, any camera you can do, that's not a big issue. Landscape photography, in this scenario, you would need, again, a bigger sensor, higher megapixel count, you know, like a full frame sensor, higher megapixel count, 36, even 42 megapixel, like Canon 5D Mark IV, Sony A7R Mark II, you know, Nikon D810, these kind of cameras. And they are excellent, I tell you, all of them. For landscapes, you have all the lenses you want, even in Sony, even in Nikon, Canon, Pentax K1. Again, it's an excellent landscape camera. And the last one I want to talk here is the product photography. Now, with product photography, you have to be careful, you know, to have, again, a lot of details in your shots. A lot of details in your shots. So you need high megapixel count, or you need something like the Olympus EM1 Mark II has the high resolution photo mode, or the Pentax has the pixel shift resolution mode. Now, these photos, I heard many tests. I didn't do the test myself, but I heard many tests that the Olympus EM1 Mark II has the high resolution photo mode, and that mode is ready to compete with a medium format photo. Contains so much details. It's the same situation with the Pentax K1. It has the tilt shift, the pixel shift resolution mode, and that competes with medium format, you know. So if you are in a product photography in a studio, you will work with strobes, you know. You need one or two lenses, you know. These cameras like the Pentax K1, Olympus EM1 Mark II, or even the Nikon D810, the Sony A7R Mark II, you know, these cameras all will be excellent if you don't want to go medium format. If you want to go medium format, there is the new Fuji mirrorless, you know, medium format camera. There is the Pentax medium format camera. There are a lot of options, but obviously they will cost double or triple the price. So, what I want to emphasize in this video, that when you talk about what kind of camera should I buy, first of all, watch and analyze what kind of photography are you into. First question. Second, what's my budget? And don't look only at the camera. You have to look also on lenses. What kind of lenses? Because the prices of the lenses can determine what kind of camera you want to buy. You might want to buy a nice Sony body, but in the same time you can see that Sony lenses, they are so expensive, you can't afford them. So you don't have third-party options over there. You are kind of pushed to the other manufacturer. That's why I want to say you have to be careful when you choose, and you have to watch carefully a few questions you have to consider before you get into and you ask yourself the question, what kind of camera should I buy? So I hope that this video was helpful to you guys, and if you have any other opinion or if you have something to add to this video, please feel free and leave a comment down below, and let's help others to make choices. And if you don't agree in something, that's not a big issue, you know. We can differ, you know. That's the beauty of this world. We are all different, so that's not a big issue. In the same time, I would like to ask you, you know, if you comment down below, I would like to ask you to comment in a polite manner, because I don't really want on my channel, you know, to be all name calling and these kind of things, you know. But most of the time, you are very nice, and I really appreciate that. So I hope that you like this video. If you like it, please like and subscribe and share my videos. Other than that, I wish you a nice day, and I'll see you in the next one.